Gobbolino, the witch's cat. On a dark and cloudy night, two tiny kittens crept out of the cave where they had been born. It was the first time they had set foot outside the cave. It was so dark that Gobbolino could barely see his twin sister, Sutika. She was as black as the night itself.
"What do you want to be when you grow up?" asked Gobbolino.
"Oh, I'll be a witch's cat like Ma," said Sutika. "I'll learn magic and how to ride a broomstick and turn mice into frogs and frogs into guinea pigs. I'll fly on the night wind with the bats and the owls saying meow, and people will say, 'There goes Sutika, the witch's cat.'"
Gobbolino was silent for a long time. Then he said,
"I'll be a kitchen cat. I'll sit by the fire with my paws tucked under my chest and purr. When the children of the house come in from school, they'll pull my ears and tickle and tease me. I'll mind the house and chase the mice and watch the baby. And when all the children are in bed, I'll climb onto their mother's lap and they'll call me Gobbolino the kitchen cat."
"Don't you want to be bad?"
"No," said Gobbolino. "I want to be good so that people will love me. People don't love a witch's cat."
Just then, a ray of moonlight fell across the kittens. Sutika hissed and arched her back.
"Brother, brother, one of your paws is white."
Everyone knows that witches' kittens are black all over from head to foot, with eyes as green as grass. In the deep, dark cave, nobody had noticed. But now the moonbeam lit up a pure white sock. And his lovely round eyes were blue. Sutika rushed into the cave.
"Ma, Gobbolino has a white sock and blue eyes, and he wants to be a kitchen cat."
Her mother came to the mouth of the cave. The witch was not far behind. They knocked Gobbolino head over heels, cuffed his ears, pulled his tail, and threw him into the darkest, dampest corner of the cave among the witch's toads. Later, he heard the witch talking to his mother.
"Sutika will make a clever little witch's cat, but what shall we do with Gobbolino?"
When the moon rose, the witch and her cat mounted their broomstick, with the two kittens in a bag behind them. They flew so fast that little Gobbolino, peeping through a hole in the sack, saw the stars flutter past like a shower of diamonds. It made him dizzy to look down. Sutika mewed with joy, but Gobbolino shivered and tears of terror dropped onto his white front paw.
"Oh, please, please stop, please," he cried,
but nobody paid any attention. At last, the witch and her broomstick swooped down onto Hurricane Mountain. An ugly old hag lived there who agreed at once to take Sutika and train her to be a witch's cat. Sutika was so happy that she hardly stopped to say goodbye to her little brother. She wanted to begin learning how to turn people into frogs and toads. But the hag refused to take Gobbolino.
"A witch's cat with a white paw? No one will want him."
So Gobbolino rode away on the broomstick behind his mother and the witch. They visited 50 caves, but none of the other witches wanted Gobbolino because of his white paw and blue eyes. They flew home again, and the witch flung Gobbolino back among the toads. In the morning, he woke up and found himself all alone. The witch and his mother had gone.
"Suppose they never come back. Oh, what shall I do?"
But then an idea struck him.
"Now I never have to be a witch's cat. I can go and find a happy home to live in forever and ever."
And he stopped crying. The witch's cave was on the edge of a forest, not far from a river. Gobbolino washed his face and coat very carefully and then trotted through the fields till the forest was out of sight. In front of him was the bubbling river with bright fishes in it that made his mouth water. Quite soon, a lovely trout, pink and gold and blue, swam slowly towards him. Gobbolino trembled with excitement and lifted a front paw. At the same moment, the trout saw him and flashed by with a swish of its tail. The kitten made one wild grab, overbalanced, and tumbled into the water. There was a terrible splash. Then he began to swim, as only a witch's cat can. He swam and swam as the river carried him far from the cave where he was born. He swam until the river ran into farmland. Some children were playing on the bank.
"Look, look," they shouted. "There's a kitten out there in the water." "He'll drown," cried one of the girls. "Quick, quick, get him out."
The boys ran to the bank with a stick and fished Gobbolino out, dripping wet.
"What bright blue eyes. He's got three black paws and one pure white."
The children took Gobbolino home to the farm to show him to their mother. And it had the kind of kitchen little Gobbolino had dreamed of. There were bright pans on the shelves, a blazing fire, and a baby in a cradle.
"Wow, what a lucky cat I am," Gobbolino thought. "Now I can settle down and be a kitchen cat forever."
The farmer's wife took Gobbolino on her lap and wiped his wet fur with a warm cloth.
"Now, where do you come from, little cat? How did you come to fall in the river? You might been drowned."
"Wow."
When his fur was dry, the farmer's wife gave him a drink of warm milk. And when she went to milk the cows, he played with the children. Every witch's kitten knows all sorts of tricks, and though Gobbolino wanted to be a kitchen cat, he knew them all. He made blue sparks come out of his whiskers and red ones out of his nose. And to the children's delight, he made himself invisible, then reappeared, hiding himself in all sorts of strange places. In the middle of all his fun, the farmer came in to tea. He saw Gobbolino's tricks, but said nothing. The children were sent off to their beds, and the little cat curled up in a box under the kitchen table. The fire died down. Gobbolino slept peacefully, dreaming and purring. Then, suddenly, tap, 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 a hobgoblin peered in at the window. Gobbolino sat up and whispered,
"Who's there?"
"Come and let me in, little cat," said the hobgoblin. Gobbolino sat and stared at him. "What a lovely kitchen! What bright dishes! What a pretty cradle! What a warm fire! Won't you let me come in?" But Gobbolino only sat and stared at him. The hobgoblin began to rattle at the window. "You kitchen cats are all the same. Look at you, all warm and safe. Look at me, lonely and cold outside." When Gobbolino heard this, he remembered being lonely and lost. He trotted to the window.
"You can come in and get warm for a little while," he said.
The hobgoblin jumped through the window and left dirty, wet footmarks all across the kitchen floor. "How are you? How are your family?" he asked, giving Gobbolino's tail a pull.
"My mother has gone away with my mistress, the witch," replied Gobbolino, "and my little sister Sutika has been apprenticed to a hag on Harrigan Mountain. I don't know how they are."
"Oh ho!" grinned the hobgoblin. "So you're a witch's kitten?"
"Wow, no, not anymore. This afternoon I became a kitchen cat, and I'll be a kitchen cat forever and ever."
The hobgoblin laughed loudly and turned head over heels. He knocked some knitting off the chair and it became tangled round the table legs.
"Oh, do be careful," cried Gobbolino.
But the hobgoblin ran into the larder and shut the door. The kitten trotted round trying to pick up the stitches, but it was no good. The hobgoblin bounced out of the larder. He had eaten all the cream. "Well, I'm going. Good night, little witch's kitten," said the hobgoblin, jumping out of the window. Gobbolino trotted back to his box and slept. Early in the morning, the farmer's wife came downstairs. She found her knitting in a tangle and all the cream stolen from the larder. Written across the floor in milky letters were the words, "Gobbolino is a witch's cat."
"Look at this mess," she yelled.
"I told you so," said the farmer. "He's a witch's cat, no good to anyone. I'm going to drown him."
When Gobbolino heard the farmer's angry voice, he was out of his box in one bound and out of the kitchen door. across the cobblestones, past the hayricks, and up the hill. Yesterday I was a witch's cat, thought Gobbolino. Last night I was a kitchen cat. Now it looks as if I'll have to be some other kind of cat. I wonder what kind it will be.
The Hare and the Tortoise. Hare was always laughing at Tortoise for being so slow.
I really can't think why you bother moving at all, he said.
Well, said Tortoise, I may be slow, but I always get there in the end. I'll tell you what, I'll give you a race.
You must be joking, you silly slow coach, sneered Hare. But if you really insist...
So one hot, sunny day, all the animals came to watch the great race. Mole lifted the starting flag and said,
Ready, steady, go!
Hare raced away, leaving Tortoise coughing in a cloud of dust. Then Tortoise moved off. Slowly, very, very slowly. Hare was already out of sight.
It's hopeless,
said the grasshoppers.
What chance does poor Tortoise have?
That silly Tortoise, thought Hare, looking back. He's so slow, I can't lose. Why should I rush? In fact, I think I'll just have a little rest.
So he lay back in the warm sun and was soon fast asleep, dreaming of cheers and prizes. All the long morning, Tortoise moved slowly, slowly along the route. Most of the animals got so bored they went home, but Tortoise just kept on going. At noon, he passed Hare dozing gently by the roadside. He didn't stop to wake him. He just kept going. Eventually, Hare woke up and stretched his legs. The sun was low in the sky, and looking back down the road, he laughed.
No sign of that silly tortoise.
And with a great leap, he raced off in the direction of the finish line to collect his prize. But then, to his horror, who should he see in the distance but that silly tortoise creeping slowly over the finish line? The flag was down. The tortoise had won. Even from the top of the hill, Hare could hear the cheering and the clapping.
It's not fair,
whined Hare.
You cheated! Everyone knows I'm much faster than you, you old slow coach.
Ah, said Tortoise, looking back over his shoulder. But I told you, I always get there in the end, slow and steady. That's me.
The Shoe Tree. John and Marian were watching their father dig the garden. It was hard work, and after one very big spadeful, he stood up straight and mopped his brow.
Look, Daddy has dug up an old boot, said Marian.
What are you going to do with it? Asked John.
I'm going to bury it right here, said Mr. Martin. There's an old wives' tale that says if you put an old shoe under a rhubarb plant, it grows much better.
Marian giggled. Will the boot grow?
Well, if it does, we'll have stewed boot for tea.
And he buried it. Later in the spring, gales blew down the rhubarb and Mr. Martin went to pick the broken stalks. He noticed a new plant growing in the rhubarb patch. He didn't pull it up, though, because he wanted to find out what it was. He looked all through his gardening books, but he couldn't find anything like it. I've never seen a plant like this before, he told John and Marion. It was rather an interesting plant, so although it had soon pushed away what was left of the rhubarb, the Martins left it to grow. It grew very well, and by the following spring it was like a little tree, over a metre high. In the autumn, greenish-white fruit appeared, and very strange it was, all knobbly and funny shapes. That fruit reminds me of something, said Mrs. Martin. Soon afterwards she realised what it was. It's like boots. Boots hanging up in pairs by their heel tabs. They really are like boots, said John in amazement, touching the fruit. Did you say boots? Said Mrs. Tripp, the next-door neighbour, peering over the garden wall. Yes, our trees grow in boots. Why, my young Bobby's getting old enough for boots, said Mrs. Tripp. Can I come over and have a look? Of course, come and see for yourself. Mrs. Tripp came round with her baby in her arms and held him up under the tree upside down. John and Marion held a pair of the fruit against his feet. Not quite, said John. Why not come back tomorrow and see if they've grown any more? Mrs. Tripp brought Bobby round the next day, but the fruit was still too small. By the end of the next week, though, all the fruit was beginning to ripen to a shiny brown, and one day a pear seemed just the right size for Bobby. So Marion picked them, and Mrs. Tripp put them on his feet. They were the perfect fit, and Bobby toddled up the garden path. John and Marion told their parents about it, and Mr. Martin said that anyone with babies who needed boots should come and pick a pair from the tree. Everybody in the village soon heard about the amazing shoe tree, and the next day there were crowds of women jostling through the garden gate with their children. Some lifted their babies up high so their little feet could be eased into the shoes to see if they fitted. Others held their children upside down to measure their feet against the fruit. John and Marion picked those that were left over and laid them on the lawn so they could put them in matching pairs. Then the mothers who had come late sat down with the children on their laps, and John and Marion went back and forth bringing pairs to be tried on until every child was fitted and every shoe fruit was taken. By the end of the day, the tree was stripped bare. One of the mothers, Mrs. White, brought her triplets and fitted each one with a pair of shoe fruits. When she arrived home, she showed them to her husband. I got them free from the Martin's tree, she said. Look, the skin's tough like leather, but inside it's really soft, so the shoes are good for children's feet. Isn't that clever? Mr. White stared long and hard at his children's feet. Take those shoes off them, he said at last. I've got an idea. The next year, the tree produced bigger fruit. And because the children's feet had grown, they all found shoes to fit. And that's what happened every year. The shoe fruit grew to match the growing feet of the children. Then, one year, a huge sign appeared outside Mr. White's house. White's Homegrown Shoes Limited, it read in large brown letters. He's been very secretive about that field at the back of his house, Mr. Martin said to his family, and now I see why. He's planted all those shoes we've given his children in the past few years, and now he's got dozens of trees, the sly old fox. They say he's going to make a fortune out of it, said Mrs. Martin bitterly. It certainly seemed as if Mr. White was going to make a lot of money. That autumn, he hired three women to pick the shoes from the trees and sort them into different sizes. Then the shoes were wrapped in tissue paper, packed in boxes, and sent to the nearest town to be sold at £5 a pair. Mr. Martin gazed out of the window and he saw Mr. White drive past in a brand new car. I never thought of making money out of my tree. You never have been much of a businessman, love, said Mrs. Martin kindly. Anyway, I'm glad all the village children can have free shoes. One day, John and Marion were walking in the field beside Mr. White's orchard. Mr. White had built a high wall to keep people out, but on top of the wall, a boy's face suddenly appeared. He was their friend, Ricky. He lifted himself over the wall and jumped down beside John and Marion. Hello, Ricky, said John. What were you doing in Mr. White's garden? The boy grinned. You'll see.
and he ran about in the long grass, picking up shoe fruit till his arms were full. "They're windfalls from the orchard. I threw them over the wall, and I'm going to take them home to my gran. She's going to make another shoe fruit pie."
"A pie?" said Marion. "I never thought of eating it. What's it like?"
"Well, the skin's a bit too tough, but if you cook the inside with lots of sugar, it's very nice. My gran makes lovely pies with it. Come round and have some if you like." So John and Marion helped Ricky carry his shoe fruit round to his grandmother's caravan, and they all had a piece of her pie. It had a rich, sweet taste, stronger than apples, and very unusual. John and Marion thought it tasted lovely, and when they went home, they picked some of the fruit that was left on the tree in their garden. "Let's bake it," said Marion. "I've just learnt how to make baked apples at school." Marion and John cooked their shoe fruit with raisins stuffed inside, and when their parents came home from work, they served it up topped with cream. Mr. and Mrs. Martin liked the fruit as much as the children did. As he finished, Mr. Martin began to chuckle. "Here, I've had a marvellous idea." The next day, he drove his old car into town, the boot filled with boxes of shoe fruit. He stopped at the street market and spoke to a stall holder. Then he began to unload the car. The stall holder wrote something on a large sign and stuck it on his stall. Soon, a crowd of people had gathered round. "Look at that! Shoe fruit! 25 pence a pound!" "I paid £5 a pear for my little boy," said one woman, and she lifted up her child and pointed at the shoe fruit he was wearing. "Look, I paid £5 for those at the shoe shop, and here they are selling the same thing for 25 pence. "Only 25 pence a pound," shouted the stallholder. "Peel off the skins and eat the tasty flesh inside. Lovely in pies, baked or stewed." "Well, I certainly won't go to the shoe shop and pay £5 again," said another woman. By the end of the day, the stallholder was very happy. Mr. Martin had given him the fruit for nothing, and now his wallet was bulging with money. The next morning, Mr. Martin drove into town again. He saw the signs in the shoe shops that said, "White's natural shoes, they grow with your children." But new signs had been added underneath. Huge reductions, prices down to 25 pence a pair. After that, everyone was happy. The village children still got their shoes free from the Martin's tree, and people in the town didn't mind paying 25 pence a pair in the shoe shops. And anyone could eat the fruit if they liked. Only Mr. White wasn't happy. He still sold some of his shoes, but he made less money than before. "Do you think I should feel guilty about Mr. White?" Mr. Martin said to his wife.
"I don't really think so. After all, fruit is for eating, isn't it?"
"And anyway," said Marion, "wasn't that what you thought when you first buried that old boot? Don't you remember? You promised a stewed boot for tea."
The Emperor's New Clothes.
"The Emperor has to be told," cried the Chancellor. "There's no money left in the exchequer. He spent it all on clothes."
But the soldier at the door of the Emperor's bedroom would not let the Chancellor in.
"I'm sorry, Your Worship, but the Emperor's in his wardrobe again, choosing something to wear. You can't go in."
Then the door burst open, and the Emperor appeared, followed by the Prime Minister.
"I tell you, I can't see anyone today. I haven't got a thing to wear. Oh, Chancellor, there you are. Put the taxes up, another 10%. I must have another suit. But you already have so many clothes, Your Majesty, and I can't raise income tax again. The people can't pay any more money." "I don't care," said the Emperor. "I want another one. I'm the Emperor. I can have what I want."
Nobody could argue with that. So, when two foreigners arrived that day at the palace gates, saying they were tailors, they were allowed to see the Emperor. The tailors said that they made the finest clothes from the most gorgeous and delicate cloth in the whole world.
Where is this cloth? Let me see it. I want to see it,
the emperor demanded. We haven't woven it yet, said one of the tailors. You supply the materials, a loom, a large, bright room, and we'll get weaving. We only supply the skill, and of course, the magic. Magic?
Magic? What magic?
Said the excited emperor. No one mean or stupid, no one unfit for their job, no one unworthy of their place in the royal household will be able to see the cloth we weave.
Really? Cried the emperor. Amazing! Wonderful! Begin right away. I'll wear them tomorrow for the big parade through the city. Chancellor, give these men everything they need.
And he strode back upstairs to his dressing room. The tailors were taken to a big, comfortable room in the palace and left to start work on the large loom. But all they did was sit down and put their feet up on the royal chairs. And when the materials were brought, silk and mohair and pearls and cloth of gold, they hid them out of sight. The emperor sat in his throne room thinking about the wonderful cloth being woven downstairs. Suddenly, he grinned wickedly.
I'll use this chance to find out if any of my ministers are mean or stupid or unfit for their jobs.
And so he sent for the chancellor.
Ask how soon it'll be ready, then come back and tell me how it looks. Of course, you may not see anything at all.
So the chancellor knocked on the sewing room door and one of the tailors opened it.
Oh, come in, Chancellor, come in. As you can see, it's almost finished.
In the centre of the room stood the big weaving loom, completely empty. The Chancellor just stared at it. What? He thought. Am I stupid? Or mean? Am I unfit for my job? I can't see anything. This is dreadful.
Yes, it's very nice. Lovely, he mumbled. I like the pattern.
Oh, I can see you have good taste, said one of the tailors. Tell the emperor his clothes will be ready early tomorrow, but we need some cloth of gold.
So the chancellor went back to the emperor, trembling and close to tears.
Well, how does it look? Oh, superb, sire. I've never seen anything quite like it.
The emperor rubbed his hands gleefully at the thought of his lovely new clothes and told himself that he'd been right to appoint the chancellor.
Good man, good man. Now, send the archbishop along to have a look at my new clothes.
The archbishop was sent in to see the magic cloth on its loom. After him, it was the Prime Minister, and then the Commander-in-Chief of the Army. They all stared at the empty loom and thought how dreadful it was not to see any beautiful cloth.
Am I mean?
Thought the Archbishop.
Am I stupid?
Thought the Prime Minister.
Am I the wrong man to be in charge of the Army?
Thought the Commander-in-Chief. And to hide their doubts, they all threw up their hands and admired the cloth.
I particularly like the fringe, said the Archbishop. What unusual colours,
said the Prime Minister.
Yes, excellent, first class, said the Commander-in-Chief.
They all trooped upstairs to tell the Emperor how wonderful the cloth was, and then the Emperor went down to be fitted for his new clothes. But as he entered the room, he was suddenly gripped by fear. Oh, my goodness! I can't see a stitch of cloth. Am I more mean or stupid than all my ministers put together? Or am I not fit to be emperor? Nobody must know I can't see the magic cloth.
What do you think of it, Your Majesty? Asked the tailors, busily unrolling tape measures.
Oh, splendid! Yes, quite splendid!
He stuttered unhappily. And they pretended to measure the emperor, undressing him right down to his underwear and fitting the loose cloth. He stood royally in front of the mirror. Well, they think I'm dressed, he thought. So I must be.
Feel the quality, said one tailor. It's all fully lined, you know, said the other. We'll work all night to make them a perfect fit.
The two tailors did nothing, of course. They just slept. On the next morning, the emperor walked to their room to put on his new clothes. While his courtiers stood around and clapped, he went through all the actions of getting dressed.
You look magnificent, Your Majesty, said the Chancellor,
anxious to keep his job.
Very regal, I must say, said the Archbishop. The people will love it, said the Prime Minister. The buckles are pretty, said the Commander-in-Chief.
News of the Emperor's magic clothes had spread through the whole city. Crowds were forming outside the palace, and the streets were lined with people waiting to see the Emperor in all his splendor. Children sat astride their father's shoulders with flags in their hands. Everybody had turned out to see the Emperor's new clothes. Slowly, solemnly, behind the royal banner and a band of trumpeters, the Emperor's procession set out through the streets. Everyone had heard how the magic cloth could not be seen by anyone mean or stupid or unworthy of their job. And nobody wanted to admit to being that.
Hooray! Hooray!
Shouted the crowd. But there were many unhappy faces as people decided they must be more mean or stupid than everyone else.
You can see them, can you? Well, of course I can see them. Do you think I'm stupid?
Meanwhile, back at the palace, the two crafty tailors packed up their store of rich materials and sneaked out of the city as fast as horses would take them. Bowing to right and left, the emperor wished that the magic cloth was not so beautifully light. He was bitterly cold. And he wished that the magic boots were not so wonderfully thin. The stones in the road were hurting his feet.
Look, look, said a father to his little boy. The emperor's coming.
Which one is he, Daddy?
The one in the wonderful clothes.
But he isn't wearing anything, Daddy. Look, he's shivering. Why isn't he wearing any clothes?
People nearby in the crowd stared at the little boy.
I'm sorry, he's too young to know any better, the child's father apologized. He's too young to be fooled, you mean, said his mother. The emperor's stark naked. Someone is making a fool of the emperor and of us.
One by one, the crowd realized that the person to either side could no more see the new clothes than they could.
Can you see them? Of course I can't. Do you think I'm stupid? The emperor's stark naked, they shouted. The emperor's dressed in nothing at all.
The emperor blushed with embarrassment. He had been fooled by the tailors, and now here he was, parading in front of all the people without a stitch of clothing. The poor emperor turned and fled back to the palace. And never again did he waste money on new clothes.
The Red Nightcaps. There was once a man who had 50 red nightcaps to sell at a fair. His wife put them in a sack and he set off on his journey. He travelled along the hot, dusty road until he came to a shady wood. The cool trees looked so inviting that the man threw his sack on the ground and sat down to rest. Then, feeling very sleepy, he took one of the red nightcaps out of the sack, put it on his head, leaned back against a tree, and fell fast asleep. Unknown to the man, a troop of monkeys lived in the wood. After a while, a big old monkey crept down a tree and towards the sleeping man. Very gently, he pulled one of the nightcaps out of the sack and popped it on his head. Then he ran back up to the top of the tree and sat there grinning. How monkeys love to copy people. Seeing what the old monkey had done, a young one came swinging down through the trees. He sneaked up to the man, took a nightcap, then ran up to the top of a tree. Then another monkey took a nightcap, then another, and another. Soon there were 49 monkeys all sitting high in the trees, chattering and grinning at each other. And on every head was a new, bright red nightcap. The monkeys made such a noise that the man woke up and saw the empty sack in front of him. He was in despair. "Oh, what shall I do?" he cried. "What shall I do? What can I say to my wife when I get home without any money, and not even the nightcaps?" He was so angry with himself for falling asleep that he pulled his red nightcap off and threw it on the ground in a rage. The 49 monkeys, sitting high in the trees, all saw what the man had done. So, all at once, they pulled off their red nightcaps and threw them down on the ground too. The man just couldn't believe his good luck, but he was very, very pleased. He picked up the 50 red nightcaps, put them back into his sack, swung it over his shoulder, and set off through the woods to sell them at the fair.
Aldo in Arcadia.
One sunny morning, Aldo was cleaning the windows of his little cottage. But he couldn't reach the ones upstairs.
Oh, those are too high for me. Anyway, I think it's time for tea. I bet Uncle Emo would like a cup. Uncle Emo! Uncle Emo, are you in there? Hey! What's happening?
Quick, catch my vacuum cleaner. Oh, too late.
Look! It's flying!
Yes, I did it with a magic spell.
What for?
Oh, I wanted it to clean the house, of course.
Gosh, look! The house is alive!
Perhaps that spell was a bit too strong.
All the things are cleaning by themselves.
This isn't so bad after all, Aldo.
Now you don't need a vacuum cleaner.
Let's go outside and watch the house.
Look, the house is washing itself in the river. Wow. Well, I'd better be going, Uncle Emo.
Thanks for the tea, Aldo. Goodbye.
It's the vacuum cleaner coming back. Hey, put me down. This is fun. I can see my cottage, and there's Uncle Emo's house. Mind the trees. They're getting close to the river. Told you we were getting close to the river. Oh, that was amazing. Hey, I've had a great idea. You can help me with my windows if you like. We'll be finished in no time.
That night, Aldo and his new friend went up to bed.
Right back home.
The Forest Troll. Once upon a time, there was an old woman who lived with her three sons in a little wooden house on the edge of a dark forest. One year, when winter was coming, the old woman asked her eldest son to go into the forest and chop down a tree for firewood.
Do I have to?
The oldest boy asked.
When it gets really cold, we could all go to bed. Then we wouldn't need to build a fire.
Oh, don't be so lazy, the old woman said. We can't stay in bed all winter. You're the strongest of my sons, so go and fetch some wood.
The oldest boy didn't like hard work, but he finally set off for the forest, carrying the smallest axe he could find. When he got there, he went to the most rotten tree he could see.
This shouldn't be too hard.
And he lifted up the axe to start chopping. He had just tapped the tree once, when he felt a thump on his shoulder. He turned around, and behind him he saw the ugliest, most revolting troll you could ever imagine. The creature had one red eye in the center of his forehead, and his purple nose was knobbly and twisted like the root of an old tree.
Hey, you! Superman!
Shouted the troll.
If you chop down one tree in my forest, I'll break you into 50 pieces.
The boy threw down his axe. He ran home as fast as his legs could carry him, and he told his family all about the giant.
Fancy being afraid of a stupid old troll,
sneered the second son.
I wouldn't be afraid.
The next morning, the second son picked up a bigger axe and set off to fetch some wood. As soon as he got to the forest, he found a large tree that looked like it would make enough wood to last the whole winter. Thwack! Thwack! The sound of his axe echoed through the forest. But before he'd got halfway through the tree, the troll appeared.
Hey, you! Muscles! What do you think you're doing? You lift that axe once more, and I'll break you into 100 pieces.
Don't think I'm scared of an old troll like you. You can't frighten me. I'm gonna chop down this tree.
We'll see about that.
And he lifted a long arm up into the tree and pulled off a big branch. He snapped it across his knee and started breaking it into tiny twigs. The second brother saw how strong the troll was and ran off home as fast as he could. He was shaking with fear when he arrived home, and his elder brother greeted him.
Well, where's all the wood, then? I met the nasty troll. He chased me out of the forest. He was much too strong to argue with. Why, he was 50 feet...
Just then, the old woman's youngest son butted in.
I wouldn't be scared of him. I'm sure I wouldn't. I'll go and fetch the wood. What, you? You're much too young to chop down a tree. With that troll, you wouldn't stand a chance. Oh, please, please let me go.
In the end, despite her fears, the old woman said her youngest son should be allowed to try his luck in the forest. So the next day, the third son picked up the biggest axe in the house. It was so heavy he could hardly carry it. He went to the kitchen cupboard and took out a firm white ball of cheese. When the brothers saw him putting the cheese into his bag, they laughed.
What do you want that for? Are you going to have a picnic with your friend, the troll?
But the young boy didn't answer, and he went off to the forest, dragging the huge axe behind him. When he reached the forest, he went to the biggest tree he could find. It was about 20 feet thick, and so tall he couldn't see the top. He struggled to lift the huge axe, but he had let it drop. And yet again, the sound brought the troll pounding through the forest.
Oh, no, not another one. Ain't no more than a boy. If you chop that tree, I'll break you into 1,000 pieces.
The boy looked straight at the ugly troll.
You just try it, and I'll crush you like I'll crush this stone.
As he spoke, the boy took the big white cheese and squeezed it hard between his hands. The cheese squirted everywhere, and the biggest blob hit the troll in his great red eye.
All right,
shouted the troll.
That's enough. Don't crush me like that stone. You can chop down any trees you want. No, I'll chop them for you if you like. I'll cut them into logs and take them back to your house.
From that day on, the troll made sure that the old woman and her family had all the firewood they needed.
No, I'll chop them down. That's it, kid. You go and sit down. That's a good boy. There we go. Right. No, I'll carry them now. Now, where would you live, eh? Your mother. Where would she live, eh? Yeah, okay, well.